Welcome and thank you for being here this evening. It is a solemn moment that we take to remember those who've gone through so much in this nation as well. We're just going to simply, if you want to turn around and wave maybe a peace sign to each other, we're just keeping this simple these days, but do acknowledge those who have gathered around here. We will now follow the bulletin, and often the words will be on your screen. On September 11, 2001, our lives were changed. Four commercial airliners were hijacked and turned into suicide missions. Two planes struck the World Trade Center, causing them to collapse within 2 hours. The third airliner crashed into the Pentagon. Hijackers redirected the fourth plane toward Washington, D.C., targeting it either toward the White House or the Capitol building, but crashed it in a field near Shanksville, Pennsylvania, after the passengers attempted to retake control of the plane. Nearly 3,000 died in the hijackings, including civilians from the United States and around the world, firefighters, police, EMTs, and paramedics. We shall never be the same after that black day. We experienced the loss of innocence as a nation, loss of security in our communities, loss of lives and livelihood for so many individuals. And yet God continues God's healing work among us. For this we give thanks to God who provides all good things for our being as individuals and as a nation. Therefore, let us mark this day by inviting God's presence among us to bless us as we remember our losses, give thanks for our survival, and pray for our future. Will the congregation please stand? Congregation may be seated as we hear the special music.
Where were you when the world stopped turning that September? Out in the yard with your wife and children, or working on a stage in LA. Did you stand there in shock at the sight of the black smoke rising against that blue sky? Did you shout out in anger, in fear for your neighbor? Or did you just sit down and cry? Did you weep for the children? They lost their dear loved ones. Pray for the ones who don't know. Did you rejoice for the people who walked from the rubble and sob for the ones left below? Did you burst out in pride for the red, white, and blue, and heroes who died just doing what they do? Did you look up to heaven for some kind of answer, and look at yourself and what really matters? I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things he gave us. And the greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning that September day? Teaching a class full of innocent children, or driving on some cold interstate? Did you feel guilty 'cause you're a survivor? In a crowded room, did you feel alone? Did you call up your mother and tell her you love her? Did you dust off that Bible at home? Did you open your eyes and hope it never happened? Close your eyes and not go to sleep? Did you notice the sunset for the first time in ages, and speak to some stranger on the street? Did you lay down at night and think of tomorrow? Go out and buy you a gun? Did you turn off that violent old movie you're watching and turn on I Love Lucy reruns? Did you go to a church and hold hands with some stranger, stand in a line to give your own blood? Did you just stay home and cling tight to your family? Thank God you have somebody to love. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things he gave us, and the greatest is love. And the greatest is love. And the greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning that September day?
Thank you, Jeff and Clara. At this moment, we light a candle in remembrance for all those who suffered and died on September 11, 2001 in New York, Pennsylvania, and at the Pentagon in Arlington, Virginia. We light a candle to remember those who still live and who suffer because of the events of that day. We'll continue with the litany. When we remember the stockbrokers, office workers, maintenance workers, bystanders, window washers, and all the others who worked together so valiantly to help each other, we say together, we remember great courage. When we recall the firefighters who rushed upstairs as most everyone else was racing out, we can say together, we remember selfless service. When we recall the police officers who stood to protect and defend the people and perform their duties until the towers came crashing down on top of them, we can say together, we remember selfless sacrifice for the safety of others. When we recall the thousands of workers, women and men, old and young, single and married, American-born and those born in countries around the world who did not escape the buildings, we can say together, we remember the loss of human life. When we recall those citizens who rushed to help, did all they could to help, we can say together. We remember and give thanks for dutiful commitment to those in distress. When we recall the people who stood in line at the nation's blood banks to make living donations from their very bodies, we can say together, we give thanks for those who live on to pass on life and love. When we remember the millions of people who gave so generously of their life and labor to endow funds to help the survivors and their families recover from their losses, we can say together, we are grateful for generosity. Remembrance begins with deep personal identification. It begins with remembering the affliction of our brothers and sisters and marking their pain as our own. Remembrance is a sacred moment when we raise up and hold to the light of the eternal moment, the good who have passed. We light a candle in penitence, recognizing that we have not done enough to address the sources of anger, hate, dehumanization, rage, and indignation that leads to acts of violence. In our sadness, horror, and shock, we acknowledge that our own fears turned murderous, and we have sought revenge, sometimes against the innocent. We confess and regret our own anger and recognize its dangers to our spirits, our health, our community, and others. In the midst of the aftermath of the events of September 11, 2001, we have been tempted to seek our own, only our own good, hear our own truth, acknowledge only our own suffering. We know that peace will come to us and to our children only when the concerns of justice anywhere become the subject of political and social will everywhere, and that no justice leads to no peace. In striving for national security and domestic peace, we run the risk of confusing might for right and participating in the very behaviors we condemn. Guard and guide our country, that in our search for security, we may not trample the rights of the innocent, nor disregard the rule of law. Let us not confuse leadership within the global community as the voice for the whole community. Repentance means to turn away from wrong deeds. Repentance means choosing instead deeds which require moral restraint and are more beneficial to all persons who suffer. We light a candle to light the way to a better world for our children and our children's children and the children of God. We recall with joy the unity we felt in the outpouring of help, kindness, thoughtful words and deeds from at home and around the world. We must hold firmly to our unity, born forward, not now of tragedy, but of loving kindness. As we travel forward in time, let us hold firm to God's compassion and commit ourselves to God's guidance and way. For God promises refuge from worldly distractions and turmoil, and is the only place we find never-ending peace. We light a candle for peace. God of the ages, before your eyes all empires rise and fall, yet you are changeless. Be near us in this age of terror and in these moments of remembrance. Uphold those who work and watch and wait and weep and love. By your Spirit, give rise in us to broad sympathy for all the peoples of your earth. Strengthen us to comfort those who mourn and work in large ways and small for those things that make for peace. Bless the people and leaders of this nation and all nations so that warfare, like slavery before it, may become only a historic memory. We pray in the strong name of the Prince of Peace. Amen. We'll continue our worship with this hymn, O God, Our Hearts Were Shattered. Of silence to allow ourselves to be still and know that God is God, to allow ourselves to admit those things, much of it expressed in the words we just said, that may still harbor in our hearts, that may not be what God would desire us to live into, but would rather have us confess, repent, and live in a new way of life. So now let's pray our own prayer of confession in the silence of our hearts now. Creator God, merciful Savior, you know our pain. You know what we harbor in our hearts. You know our anger, our frustration, our desire for revenge. You know our fears. Lord, we confess those to you, knowing that you are a merciful God. And you desire to set us free. And you did. You showed us such freedom and forgiveness on the cross. And it's in the power of Jesus' name, which as a minister of the Church of Jesus Christ, I declare your entire sins forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll continue our service with Speaker Mary Milliken.
Boy, I'm ambitious for my height, actually.
Whatever you prefer, Mary.
That's fine. Okay, sorry. I'm a little snug in this uniform some 10 years after I retire. Okay, so September 11th, 2001. Do you remember where you were that day? I grew up with tales from my father who talked about the attack on Pearl Harbor. He was a young 17-year-old sailor awaiting a transport ship to San Diego. He was on his way to ship in Hawaii. America was attacked that day by foreign agents in our own land. The first time war was brought into our country since the Civil War. It was, according to the speech made by President Franklin D. Roosevelt, a day that will live in infamy. I remember where I was that Tuesday morning on September 11th. I had returned the week previously from an assignment in the Washington Navy Yard in Washington, D.C. I was loading my children into the car to bring them to school. I turned the radio on to listen to the news. There was a tragedy unfolding in New York. At 8:45 Eastern Time, an American Airlines flight fully loaded with 20,000 gallons of jet fuel had crashed into the North Tower of the World Trade Center in New York City. As people looked on in horror, wondering what was happening, running to help or some running away, a second jumbo jet, a United Airlines flight, crashed into the South Tower of the World Trade Center. This was no accident. Less than an hour later, another American Airlines flight flew into the west side of the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. We later learned of another hijacked flight that was headed toward either the White House or the United States Capitol. On this flight, the passengers and air crew fought against the assailants, and the plane crashed into a field near Shanksville, Pennsylvania. There were miracles that happened on that day. The first, 6 people who had been trapped in the towers survived. Of the thousands of people who were already at work or in or near the Trade Center, 10,000 more survived and were treated for injuries. The total of number of deaths that day were 2,977. These deaths included 265 people, including the hijackers, on the 4 flights. The youngest passenger was a 2-year-old, the oldest 89. There were also 343 New York City firefighters and paramedics who were lost. An additional 23 New York City police officers and 37 Port Authority officers who were helping to evacuate the towers were also lost to us. At the Pentagon, 55 military personnel perished, including a resident of Kenosha, Wisconsin, Lieutenant Commander Pat Murphy. In Pennsylvania, an additional law enforcement officer was killed trying to assist at the crash site. Of the people who died, 2,605 were Americans. The remaining 372 people were from 90 different countries around the world. The greatest miracle that happened that day was that those attacks, the first on American soil by foreign agents in 60 years, brought our country together. At 9 p.m., President George Bush addressed the nation and said, in his closing remarks, "Terrorist attacks can only shake the foundations of our biggest buildings, but they cannot touch the foundation of America. These acts shatter steel, but they cannot dent the steel of American resolve." Today, we honor those who gave their lives that day and those who continue to give what they can to help others to live as many people around the world wish. In America, we are free to worship, be educated, choose our livelihoods, and live our lives secure in the knowledge that we can make a difference in our community, our country, and the world. I remember where I was, and I am proud to be American.
Thank you, Mary. If you so choose, I invite you to open up your pew Bible to John, the 11th chapter. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. It's a long passage, so it will be helpful to be able to read this together, but there's a lot going on. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them." And after saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, will he be all right?" Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, and I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would have not died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher, Rabbi, is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would have not died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here so that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and his feet bound with strips of cloth and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to him, unbind him and let him go. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I have not seen war. I have not been on the front lines of a fire or car accident that left people injured, maimed, or dead, or gunfire that has slain somebody, or a plane crash that has killed many. I have not witnessed terror, nor seen a collapse of a building before my eyes. But I have witnessed hate and anger and deep sorrow at the loss of human life. To have a war on our land, some may say that we have not been experienced since Civil War days, from some perspectives, but war is actually an everyday occurrence if we have hate or anger towards someone. Often at the very root of hate is grief, anger, or loss, and oftentimes loss of control. Let us consider these five stages of grief. Certainly, our service today points to the grief we experienced 20 years ago when we thought our country was in many respects safe or at peace. And for those who bore the gravity of such loss in those places and the families and friends and co-workers and frontline workers, such incredible pain and loss. And yet today we consider our grief and sorrow. Considering the multitude of ways the pandemic has changed our lives, many people have experienced grief in reaction to all kinds of losses this year. Grief can be experienced in reaction to any significant loss, whether it be a job or income loss, loss of child, loss of routine, sense of safety, loss of community and togetherness, or a loss of a loved one. Instead of consisting of one emotion or state, grief is better understood as a process. About 50 years ago, experts noticed a pattern in the experience of grief, and they summarized this pattern as the five stages of grief, which are denial and isolation, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. The experts who published these stages have since clarified that someone who is grieving could experience the five stages in any order, and they may experience only some of the stages as opposed to all of them. Further, there is no set amount of time for which someone grieving will remain at any one stage, and someone can be experiencing more than one of the stages at one time. In other words, grief is very personal and a very nuanced experience for each, and everyone grieves in their own way. Understanding the dynamic of the nature of grief can help us in coping through the loss, as well as help those who are going through a grieving process. Let's reflect a little deeper on these five stages of grief. Denial and isolation. When we lose someone or something important to us, it is natural to reject the idea that it could be true. In turn, we may isolate ourselves to avoid reminders of the truth. Others who wish to comfort us may only make us hurt more while we are still coming to terms with the loss. You could say we remain in our tomb, not coming out. Anger. When it is no longer possible to live in denial, it is common to become frustrated and angry. We might feel like something extremely unfair has happened to us and wonder what we did to deserve it. This anger can lash out on others. It comes out in many ways to try to control things too. Bargaining. In this stage, we might somehow seek to change the circumstances of the situation causing one's grief. For example, a religious person whose loved one is dying might seek to negotiate with God to keep the person alive. Bargaining may help the grieving person cope by allowing them a sense of control in the face of helplessness. Depression. In this stage, we feel the full weight of our sadness over the loss. Feeling extremely down in the wake of a loss is normal. This depression can be short-term or can last a long while. It's important to seek help from a doctor and counselor. Finally, acceptance. Eventually, the grieving person may come to terms with their loss. Accepting a loss does not necessarily mean the person is no longer grieving. In fact, many grief experts say that grief can continue for a lifetime after a major loss. And coping with the loss only becomes easier over time. Waves of grief can be triggered by reminders of the loss long after it has happened and long after the person has accepted it. These waves may also trigger a crossover into any of the other four stages of grief. And so in summary, grief is personal, nuanced, and a very complicated process. It will not look the same for two people who are grieving. However, those who are grieving may experience similar emotions along the way. With that backdrop, let us turn to our scripture reading, God's Word for us today. Lazarus was bound with bandages that refrained him from moving. We all have wounds. Some of us, very serious wounds. And the bandages that wrap around us keep us from rising from the grave or leaving the tomb and rising to new life. Like Martha, who was ticked at Jesus, not getting there on time when Jesus was dying, when Lazarus was dying, her brother, some of us are ticked that Jesus didn't do more for us in whatever situation we've gone through. Or we are ticked at someone in our lifetime that did not do more, didn't say more, or actually did something that harmed us significantly. Every day of their lives, the people who were most impacted by the fall of the towers and the plane crashes everywhere have to deal with such incredible loss and potential wounds that keep them from experiencing the full grace of God. It's understandable. There is no condemnation. What this means, though, is that we too may need to accompany people in their excruciating times of grief. A few weeks ago, I was at the bar at Maple Inn following a softball game with the Ashapin Old Sox as the whole team and spouses went out for a fish fry. I met a recent widow at the bar. I'd never met her before, and she was still reeling from the death of her husband. She was angry, not at the death, but by the lack of comforting response and care from those that she thought she would receive from people in her life over the loss of her husband. Her woundedness was made obvious before my eyes, a complete stranger. Even as I was a complete stranger to her, I listened, comforted, and was even a little playful with her. And this gave her comfort. I could tell. But more than that, I think she needed peace. the opposite of peace, maybe war for some. For others, it is fear. And still others yet, loneliness. Countless people groups all over the globe experience such war, fear, and even loneliness that steals their peace. My favorite saint is Saint Francis. I wear a cross in thinking of him. His prayer often comes to mind for me as the prayer I need to pray. If you know his story of living a life of great wealth as a child, and then he made a vow of poverty and service to the poor and poor in spirit. Saint Francis took great care of a lot of suffering people in his time. Thanks to his help, these desperate people felt dignified with a ray of hope upon experiencing such compassion. In his prayer, the lines, "Where there is despair, hope, and where there is darkness, light," express the desire to give hope to the otherwise hopeless. You know this prayer. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Eventually, as we leave this solemn service, let's see ourselves as Jesus' instruments, Jesus' agents of peace. That it's the Holy Spirit that works in and through us, so that where there is hatred, you and I sow love instead. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. As we all need consolation, let's not worry about ourselves as much, or as rather, let us console others who mourn. It may not be so much that we need to be understood, but seek first to understand others. And yes, we love, we give, we pardon. And it is in this consoling and this loving and this giving and this pardoning that we are ultimately born into a new life in Jesus Christ. Our bandages have been removed and we are set free to live in the joy of Christ. Amen.
Were gone, I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I'd thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. An American, where at least I know I'm free, and I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
God of abundance, you cause streams to break forth in the desert
and manna to rain from the heavens. Accept the gifts you have given us. Unite them with the offerings of our lives to nourish the world you love so dearly. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And if you'd please join me in confessing the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Revealing God, you have made yourself known through bread and wine, water and word. Continue to nurture your church, that it is a place where your presence is experienced and shared. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creating God, you brought life into being and called it good. Bring new creation to lands devastated by tornadoes, floods, fire, and other disasters. We pray for Louisiana and those impacted by Hurricane Ida, those in New York and the East Coast impacted by flooding, the people and communities affected by wildfires in California, Montana, Oregon, Washington, and Canada. We pray today for those impacted in our own community by the fire at Culver's. We pray for their livelihood and that they would be able to find new jobs. Restore forests and curb overflowing waters. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember the workers, fire and police officers who died in the World Trade Center Trade Center on 9/11, 20 years ago. We remember their families, friends, and coworkers who grieved then and grieve still. We remember the people in the airplanes who died, the people in the Pentagon, and we remember the bravery of the passengers on Flight 93 who died in the field in Pennsylvania, the bravery of the police officers, the firefighters, the first responders who went into the Trade Center after the attack as others were trying to leave. We pray for those from Lower Manhattan diagnosed with cancer from exposure to the toxins at Ground Zero. We thank and pray for the 1,400 9/11 rescue workers who have since died. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Protecting God, you desire all people to live in peace and safety. Provide for all who are in danger. Strengthen first responders as they help to meet complex needs of others. Provide care and compassion as they face trauma themselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Transforming God, you announce freedom to the oppressed. Provide haven and comfort to the refugees from Afghanistan. Break chains of discrimination and injustice. Amplify the voices that go unheard and inspire us to advocate for those who are overlooked. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forming God, you gather this community together. Shape our lives together, that in our prayer, praise, and worship, we honor you and one another. Keep our disagreements civil and increase our joy in working together. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are sick or injured. Please join me in praying for those in our community who are listed on the screen. David D., Jamie Christensen, Jeff Daly, Mark T., Mike N., Linda Frederick, Kathy L., and for those serving in the military around the globe and those who have returned home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Redeeming God, you accompany your people through every stage of life. We give thanks for the saints who now rest in your embrace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Lynn, for those carefully and inspiring crafted prayers. We know that Jesus was breaking bread with his disciples, and on this particular night, he was going to be betrayed by one of them. But even that, he broke the bread, gave thanks, and gave it for all to eat, saying, "This is my body given for you." Following supper, he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us join in the prayer he taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are welcome to the table. We'll continue with kneeling at the altar. Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Ministry moments. For some of you who are joining us on the journey of studying the New Testament through the Bethel Bible series, we will start next week. We do have the binders and they are available in the fellowship hall. So we probably have about 40 households represented. So I'm very excited about the commitment from St. Olaf to say we're going to dig into the New Testament. If you are not going through the Bethel Bible series, you will be getting information on what to read each week. We do invite you and encourage you to open up your Bibles, take the dust off, as Jeff's saying about, and to open that up and read some of the passages that we're recommending. It's all about Jesus, and we're going to be going through that whole fall season to learn more about Jesus, why Jesus, and who is Jesus. Any other ministry moments that we need to uplift? Roger.
Flyers and tickets are here for the Mining Irritation event on October 16th. I have both. If you're a person who would like to put up a flyer or two or three in a local business that you get into, get them for me tonight. If you're ready to purchase tickets for the event, I have those here. See me at the surface out there in the gathering area. If you want to take tickets, sell to others, please take them if you're ready to do so. Thanks.
This is a connecting point with our neighbors. What we realize we do really well is hospitality. And there are people recently who went to some bluegrass festival or something. And they said, we really enjoyed that, and we really liked you guys, and we want to become members. So I gave them a tour the other day. So these matter. This is an opportunity for us to extend a greeting to someone, invite them in, and they may need just that right now. So this is a great opportunity. Seeing nobody else standing, receive this blessing. We are one people in one nation, united around the foundations of life, liberty, and justice for all. God has brought us this far and will continue to be with us in our future. That word of God's promise is given to you. God's healing is yours. God's prosperity will be restored. Now go forth into the world, lending aid, giving comfort, lifting hearts, sharing your talents and gifts for the benefit of one another, of our nation, and of all the world. And may God go with you and give you peace. Amen. 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 Please stand for God Bless America. There'll be fellowship and dessert following the service. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.